adventure resides deep within all of us. Hidden corners of the earth exist that took form and meaning from the endeavors of great explorers. Their experiences have been captured and immortalized in tales passed down from generation to generation. These stories give our landscapes a voice, a character that still resonates with those in search of something greater than themselves. Now, as the world seemingly shrinks around us, the deep residual need for the unknown manifests into what you recognize as a modern-day explorer. Ambitions and priorities have changed, and the challenge of pushing oneself in hostile environments with unknown outcomes must now coexist alongside the domestic landscape we have fabricated into being.
I quite like how obscure this place is. You know, it's not the biggest, it's not the best, it's not the tallest, it's not the most famous. Nobody knows about this thing. It's quite unique within this landscape. I like things that stand out. I've done a bunch of trips over the years, and in recent years I've done a bunch with the same team. But that team has kind of dispersed, and it's because everyone's having kids. So all of a sudden it's much more difficult to find the amount of time that you need for a trip like this. My wife, Jessica, was pregnant when I was in Antarctica, which was 2.5 years ago. So my daughter Freya was born 6 months after we got back. And of course, Stanley, my right-hand man, a main climbing partner for all the expeditions I've done in the last few years, died in a wingsuit flying accident just over a year ago. It's definitely made me question everything, but what's been has been, and what is happening is happening. It feels different being away with a different crew, but at the same time, I didn't put this team together by chance. I've picked everyone carefully. So the team that we've got here, there's Matt Pickles. Matt's a very good climber, but he's never been on any proper adventures. I guess he's been slowly convinced over the years that he should try this big hairy ass stuff. Next on the team, we've got Waldo Etherington. He's not a super experienced rock climber, but he's a very experienced tree climber. Which I laughed at when he told me, but basically he's climbed all of the tallest trees in the world. But also, Waldo is more of a climber than he lets on. He's actually, since I asked him to come on this trip, he's done more rock climbing than most would in several years. So I reckon he might be a bit of a secret weapon. And then the last man on the team is Joe Mole. He's from South Africa, so they are a slightly different breed down there. They're tough, they're independent, and now he lives in Switzerland, so he's got a lot more alpine experience than most of the guys. He's a good kind of guy to have around, I could tell that immediately. You know, he's the kind of guy who just quietly gets along with stuff.
African ninja.
Where are you going?
Right, say nice things.
sun doesn't set, but we're trying to figure out what the coldest times of the day are relative to sun direction and shade and all that. It's really bad conditions. You sink up to your knees every step and sometimes right up to your waist. During the melt after the winter snows, that's the worst time for falling down crevasses, for going across snow bridges and then popping through unexpectedly. There is shed loads of avalanche debris coming down from those big seracs above the wall and from the huge hanging glacier to the right. But to be honest, what's scary about going up there is you are into a dangerous realm. And this is the first time I've ever done this kind of thing as a dad. I'm kind of intentionally not thinking about my daughter Freya. Certainly not when you're walking across a crevasse field. It's there in the back of your mind, but you need to focus and concentrate on what you're doing. But this is kind of, it's not the first trip I've been on, but it's the first major expedition with this level of risk that I've been on. And it does feel a bit weird, I have to say. So we're up at the top of the snow. Are you feeling mini pics?
Slightly nervous, but with good reason, I think.
First part of the snow slope was all right, a bit soft. The second part was pretty bad. Really soft, really steep, a bit loaded. Don't really want to be doing that way too many times.
Wet snow, loose rock. That's just what we came for.
I think we'll all be feeling a lot more comfortable in an hour or so when we get on the rock.
Right, we've done one pitch.
Well, we made a start. We did the first two pitches, but long pitches. Fixed 100 metres of rope up to a ledge. We're doing pretty well. Really dehydrated.
Got to get back down to camp. One more load, and we blast.
Stanley died in March 2014, 6 months after Freya was born and his wife was 7 months pregnant. He's left a widow and an orphan child, which is terrible. You know, it was a hardcore, gnarly thing that he was doing, but he'd done a lot of them before. And I think he was basically going extra hard because he knew he only had a few weeks of freedom left. I think if it wasn't for that, he probably wouldn't have done what he did on that day. But because he was perhaps feeling he might never get to do it again or wasn't going to be as free to do it in the future, he took a gnarly line and he botched it and he screwed it up and he died. You know, initially I got quite angry when I thought about what a terrible mistake he made, what an idiotic thing to do. But that was the initial reaction. Now, a year later, I miss him, you know, he's gone. You know, he's my best friend, basically. It'll be apparent in a week or two whether or not we are going to miss Stanley. I am going to miss Stanley. He's not only one of my best friends, he was a big wall climbing machine. He lived in Yosemite, whereas I'm not at my fittest right now, and there's not really any other world-class climbers on the team. So there's enough motivation and strength, but there is a lack of experience. So hopefully, you know, I've got enough knowledge and, dare I say, wisdom to lead the other guys and encourage them to get us where we need to be.
Big avalanche. It's quite kind of frighteningly regular, but thankfully it's not too close to us.
Well, we're up here at the Bedouin camp, so we're pre-committed now and we're going to start moving stuff up.
...24 minutes.
Upright, 1 meter. Okay.
Looking good.
Another 20.
All right, here she comes.
I had forgotten what a lot of hard work this stuff involves. It's endless, endless faffing and carrying loads and resorting and organising and effort and work. But it gets you to places where no one's ever been before. Morning. Just enjoying a few rays of midnight solarium before it goes away. Nice to be up here in the sun.
No sunshine. Bit of Marvin Gaye, that's what we need.
Ooh, I heard it through the grapevine. Honey, honey, yeah.
Knots and ballads.
Yeah, knots and ballads. That's the kind of guy I am. Knots and ballads guy, me.
Look here. Let me tell you something. I don't worry myself about who my baby gives a thing to. You better hear what I say.
That was a bit exciting.
I'm warning all you fellas to look at life the way I do. Come on now. I'm warning all you fellas to look at life the way I do. Oh yeah, yeah, yeah. There ain't no doubt about it. Somebody else is gonna love her too. Oh yeah. You better come on now and hear what I say. You don't have to worry. She's gonna give it away. She's gonna give it away. Let me tell you what she'll do. Woo. When she goes out at night, I don't worry about what she's gonna do. She's gonna give it away. She's gonna give it away. You don't have to worry, baby. She's gonna give it away. It just ain't no use in worrying now. She's gonna give it away.
Coming in, wall team. This is Bedouin camp, over.
I just climbed the pitch of my life. It was fucking awesome.
So Joe's got through a decent stance and might be able to hear that tapping. That's him putting in a bolt by hand in granite, which means I've probably got about 15, 20 minutes where I'm not needed. So I can sit down here and look at the view. Check it out. All the way down there is the glacier. It's literally changing before our very eyes. Another huge glacier at the back. Even the cliffs are changing colour day by day. They're starting to look a bit greener as little plants that have been knuckled down, hibernating over winter, starting to come through now. Closest thing I'm getting to a tree anyway. Jesus Christ.
That just came out of nowhere. Right in the balls. It destroyed my sleeping bag. Oh well, at least I'm not dead.
That's pretty lucky, that.
To be honest, it did shake me up quite a lot. You know, things could have gone very differently if that rock had been a lot bigger. And I guess I started thinking a lot about Freya and Jess and, you know, what are we doing up here? Why are we here? It's dangerous. You know, there's no two ways about it. When you put yourself in these positions, bad shit can happen. But it kind of is part of the game.
So, Leo, what have you done to yourself?
Bit of a spanking. Heavy rack. Steep rock, wet jams. I'm gonna tape up, another go.
Here we go. Got through the major wet part.
Halfway up the wall, we found the mother of all ledges, and we've just got splitter cracks everywhere.
Nearly packed up the Bedouin camp and we are going to move up to the Arctic Hotel, a big ledge system 260 metres higher. But no mean feat getting all this stuff up there. We're going to do it in one haul. Repeat.
There she goes.
How's it going, James? Four, five, and four.
Matt Pickles is about to set off up there.
How are you feeling about that?
It's basically everything that I'm not very good at, so...
Now I'm off.
I think it's going to be quite hard. I'm quite full on.
Fuck!
But it looks awesome. If we can get to the flake on the end, it's going to be absolutely amazing. Such a wild position. It's been cool up on the wall, especially hanging out actually on the face, you know, it gives you a lot of time to think. Time to think about why you do things. There's certain events in your life that kind of change your outlook, I think. Unfortunately for me, 4.5 years ago, my dad passed away. I found him, like, unconscious and unresponsive, and he wasn't breathing on the floor, like, at home. I had to do CPR on him for 40 minutes before the ambulance arrived, and it was really traumatic. Like, he died in my arms, you know? But overnight, that changes your view on life, you know? It's a very stressful thing. And that's kind of explains why I've done a lot of things I've done over the last couple of years. You know, I've travelled quite a lot. You know, I've tried to see as much of the world as possible. And like I say, if you get the chance to do something like this, you've got to just go out there and do it, because it probably won't happen again. It's just trying to do the things that make you happy, I think. And things like this, I suppose it does make me happy. Kind of what's led us here, for all of us, I think.
That was amazing, wasn't it?
So cool pulling around that roof, feel like such a hero.
So, status report. We are a little bit over halfway up the wall on a big massive ledge. Above us are four pitches that lead to the main system we've been aiming for all along. The last one of those, the fourth pitch, is the blank section. And I'm recovering from my fight with the crack the other day, saving some energy for the endless hand cracks in the head wall, which hopefully we're going to get to after I lead the pitches leading across there, which might require a little bit of. So far, so good. I mean, this is why we came here. To be climbing things that no one's ever climbed before in this amazing place, high up on the wall, self-sufficient. It's pretty amazing. So here we are, approaching the blank section. There's this little roof right here which looks free climbable, and then there's about maybe 10 meters of pretty blankness to get across to the start of the black streak, the left-hand black streak that runs all the way to the top.
Okay. Oh no.
has just got to the place we were trying to get to that we've called the slug. And now there's an exceptionally blank bit. And we're gonna try and use some rivets just to get across this blank section, hopefully into this crack system on the other side, which is gonna get us to the top. Yeah, I don't know, I'm a tree climber. I don't know how we got this far, to be honest.
I take what I can get. You were the only part of me that I could ever like. And all you take from me is time that I misplaced inside the dark, the stormy sea. The burning tears that sang.
Six rivets down. Four or five more to go. Getting there. No crack at all.
Way higher up, maybe. It doesn't look as good as we were hoping. How disappointing.
Well, that didn't go quite as hoped. I managed to get across the blank section just using six rivets, and I got to the feature, which we've been aiming for, but unfortunately, it wasn't the hand crack we were hoping for, which is fast and easy. It's an aid seam, which means it's slow and hard. And I've decided to belay here a bit lower than I wanted to originally, because I'm knackered. Been on lead for about 6 hours there, and my hands are all bloodied, and it's bloody freezing. It's like the 18th of July today, my daughter's second birthday. But we're at 71 degrees north.
Must be almost 50 pieces in that pitch.
You know, thinking about Freya celebrating her second birthday yesterday up here whilst I'm doing this, it makes you think. But I'm just being super safe, and I don't feel like we're taking any unnecessary risks. Really, it's good to be here. It's good to be pushing it. It's good to be out here. Freya, these pictures are for you, sweetheart. Daddy's using all his years of knowledge and skill to climb this big scary mountain up here in Greenland, and you come home safely to you in a week. Woo! I've never really enjoyed aid climbing. I find it very artificial and hard work. And it took hours, and it wasn't until about 3 hours into the pitch I realized I hadn't said a word, hadn't spoken to Waldo. It's so engrossing, and you know, it's basically, that's as good as aid climbing gets. Half a mile up an overhanging cliff in remote Arctic Greenland. And throughout the course of that pitch, I think I sort of came around to the fact that, you know, okay, it didn't go free, but that doesn't mean it's not absolutely amazing. It was hanging on that belay at the end of the major difficulties. I knew we were going to summit after that. It was in the bag. You could see the angle eased, the cracks got wider. In hindsight, that was the highlight of the entire expedition for me.
Okay, Leo, I'm safe. Whew. That's pitch 13, 14, 15, 16, 17, 18. I'd pitch 18 or 19. Getting there, getting there. Thank you.
Is it in your skin? Is it in your bones? All your honor undertow. And there it goes, the middle row. There goes everything I told.
It's the 22nd, we're pushing for the top. It's been like a month of not seeing any wildlife. I've seen like four moths, two birds, and a bunch of moths. But check out this guy. He's in full flower, he's loving it. Ah, refreshing. God, I can't wait to get back into those trees. In a bit of a snowstorm right now.
Dumbstruck. So beautiful. These snowflakes and this rock, it's like this huge hall of granite up here. Like you expect one of those dwarfs from Lord of the Rings to like stick his head over the edge up there.
Ladies and gentlemen, this is the last real pitch. Might be a little bit of scrambling after this. But that's the top, look, right there. You sometimes forget that there's like a 1,000 meter cliff down there. Sometimes you remember and you go, ooh, such a big drop, man. Right, I'm off.
You've got to push pretty hard to do this kind of thing, but there comes a point when you've got to be willing to say no. And I don't think we've got to that point. You know, we've come close a few times. I think Stanley was reckless on that day when he died. I think he made a terrible decision. But I think I've been reckless over the years. But hopefully those are the decisions, those are the moments that you learn from.
Yeah.
Yeah, man.
It's been a rough ride the last few years. It's made me grow up a lot. I've been forced to mature quite brutally. But I don't think that's a bad thing, you know, you've got to embrace each stage of life. I'm not a kid anymore.
Yeah, man.
Times have changed, but that's good. It's cool to be here. It's cool to be here with these young guns, and we've nailed it. Look, we're up here. We did it. We've done it with an acceptable degree of safety. Okay, sometimes you get close to the line. It's a fine line between bravery and stupidity. Obviously, you've got to have a certain amount of courage to set off on a mission like this. There's gonna be danger, it's gonna be hard. It's a hard line to tread, but I think we've done it.
Yeah.
You're on now.
It's a long way down.
I want my baby girl.
The hardships and hazards of the mirror wall quickly fade to memory, replaced with the simple domestic joys of family life. It's always good to be home. But no sooner has one dragon been slain than one further, fiercer, appears on the horizon. That summit was not the destination. The adventure does not end here.